Ramsey TV.
In Little Rock, today, a helpless yet extremely clever infant decided of its own free will to be rescued from a burning building. Firefighters, responding to the infant's sovereign decision, rushed into the building and rescued the child. Never before in firefighting history has an unconscious child shown such unbendable resolve. The firefighters, able to do only what the infant believed they could do, were amazed at the marvelous physical feat this senseless weanling forced them to accomplish. As the baby regained consciousness, it was asked by a Christian Daily News reporter to detail exactly what happened. While we are not able to confirm the quote, the reporter is fairly certain that the infant said, "Welcome to MZTV. I'm Martin Sender, your host," and that was an article from the Christian Daily News, Volume 17, Issue 3, from July 10th, 2005. Actually, I wrote that little bit. It is in my book, The Really Bad Thing About Free Will. Yeah, it's fun making up these things, but truth is stranger than fiction because the Christian world actually believes that God asks helpless people to help themselves. Are we helpless or aren't we? That's the question. I'm going to talk about the famous, should I say the infamous mystery card that Christians love to put on the table when they are completely cornered and trapped in their hypocrisy. But let's look at the source of this Christian Daily News article, helpless yet extremely clever infant. And that's exactly the deal, isn't it? I'm going to read a little excerpt from my book. You can order this today. Yes, it's called The Really Bad Thing About Free Will. That's Mike Telep on the front of that book. I shot this cover at his house. We were there for a Bible study. Mike Telep was one of the folks on the Grace Cafe broadcast. He is here posing as a person who is strong enough and mighty enough, even though somehow helpless at the same time. We don't know how that can be, but it just is that helpless people can accomplish the most amazing thing in the world, which is to choose Jesus Christ as their Savior. This is known as the general invitation doctrine. And this is what it says. Well, this isn't word for word what it says, but this is my interpretation in The Really Bad Thing About Free Will of what it says. The general invitation doctrine. Basically, it's God pulls into your driveway and, finding your house burning down, honks the horn a couple of times. Being a hands-off God, which is the essential teaching of human free will, hands-off God, he can't influence you or else you wouldn't be free. He then closes his eyes, plugs his ears, and starts humming loudly to himself so that he won't be tempted to influence your decision to either get into or not get into his car. So he pulls up, honks the horn, and he probably, being God, wants to help, wants to go into the house and just make something happen, arouse the stupid person in there and get them the hell out. You're in a burning house. You're going to die. I can't let this happen. I'm God. I'm nice. So he's probably, maybe he's hearing some help, some cries. People who are disabled maybe, or a baby crying. And he's tempted to want to go in and save it because, again, he's nice by nature, is what we're told. But he can't because he's a hands-off God. He's got to leave it up to you. So he plugs his ears, closes his eyes, and whistles something so that he's not going to be influenced by anyone's cries. He doesn't want to hear their cries because then he might be moved to pity, might be moved to passion. That can't be. As much as he wants to do something, he can't. He's limited himself. He's really screwed himself out of helping anybody. God has screwed himself out of helping anybody by giving everybody, according to the teaching, a free will. And that's why I'm telling you, it would be so frustrating to want to help, to know exactly what to do to save people. But he can't do it because everyone has been given a gift. The gift of free will. The gift of being able to reject God and then damning yourself to hell for eternity. That's a gift, people. Don't tell me that's not a gift. And God has to protect that gift. So he just, amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Oh, this is the Christian God. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound of saves a wretch like me. Oh, I think I hear that person screaming, but I can't go help them. It sounds like a squeal of desperation, but I can't do anything because I've castrated myself. It's a Christian God. Terrible. So he plugs his ears, starts humming loudly to himself so that he will not be tempted to influence your decision to either get into or not get into his car. From this point on, it's entirely up to your strength, your wisdom, to open the door and get in the car. Well, we have a problem with this scenario. The problem is you're upstairs lying unconscious on the floor. Yeah, Martin, that's a ridiculous analogy. It is. Well, I'm kind of basing it on Romans 5, verse 6, which is, while we were still helpless, Christ died for our sakes. That's Romans 5, 6. While we were still helpless, still in accord with the era. And in this book, I do something very helpful, and I define the word helpless. Listen to this, helpless. This is the word used in Romans 5, 6. Helpless. Unable to help oneself. Well, let me repeat that. Unable to help oneself. Weak or dependent. Oh, a dependent person. Leaning upon or wishing upon a God who is unable to help because he's castrated himself, locked himself out of human life altogether because he can't influence anybody. That's a deadly combination. Being dependent on God and then God not being able to do anything, that's a rough combination right there. That's going to damn a lot of people to hell. What a pity, too. Unable to help oneself, weak or dependent, deprived of strength or power. Powerless. Hey, let's just get right to the point. Instead of deprived of power, how about powerless, incapacitated? So according to this so-called general invitation teaching, the main Christian teaching, God invites you in. It's a general invitation. The assumption is that we must have the power to accept the invitation. Going to get to that in a second. God offers helpless sinners a general invitation to accept his son. I'm assuming most of you caught the absurdity of that, but in case there are some Christians watching, I understand. I'm going to spell it out for you. The absurdity, did you catch that, of expecting helpless people to do something? Expecting helpless people to do something. That's also a big problem. Besides people dependent on a God who cannot do anything on their behalf. Oh, he can't. If he does, then he's violated the vaunted free will. So you're upstairs in this burning house, lying unconscious on the floor. Helpless. Romans 5, 6, I remind you. But you better hurry. You better what? God's outside waiting, and you better hurry because this buggy's moving on. God's not going to wait forever for you. Because once God pulls out of the driveway, your chance to get in the car is over. If forget for a moment that salvation has absolutely nothing to do with chance. It has to do with the Son of God dying a most horrible death on a Roman stake. That's what salvation has to do with. That's the opposite of chance. That's like something that actually paid the price for everyone. That's not chance. And yet, it's still presented as a chance. Strange. But the really crazy part, if that's not crazy enough, the really crazy part of this general invitation business is that those who believe it call it, are you ready for this? People who believe this nonsense of expecting helpless people to help themselves, they call it salvation by grace. Yeah, I'm not kidding. That's what they call it. Salvation by grace. I don't know, it kind of sounds to me like salvation by being strong enough and smart enough to get into God's car while God is closing his eyes, plugging his ears, and humming to himself. That's what it sounds like to me. And I have a picture of God. I have an illustration of God. And he is pulled up to the burning house. You got to see this. There it is. Okay. There it is. All right. I'll put it up here. You can see it better. And the caption says, absolutely, totally helpless invalid. I'll give him 10 more minutes. Now that is funny. Absolutely, totally helpless invalid. I'll give him 10 more minutes. Yeah. Maybe, why don't you give him 20 more minutes? Why don't you give him 20 more years? A totally helpless invalid, you could give 200 years and they will not come because they can't. And whenever you confront Christians with this contradiction, they always do this. They will play the mystery card every time. The mystery card is, well, it's just a mystery. It's like, okay, how can you be helpless and God ask you to help yourself at the same time? I mean, either you're helpless or you're not helpless. Either you're helpless and you can't do anything, or you're not helpless and you can do something, like respond to God honking his horn outside your burning house. Which is it? Or God is in control of everything. God is sovereign. It's the way it's usually said. Except over 8 billion human wills, which he's not sovereign over, or the devil, or anything evil that happens. He can't control any of that because it's all gotten out of hand. But God's still in control. I know I can do nothing to save myself. I can do nothing to save myself. Nothing. I am helpless. I am locked up in stubbornness. No one righteous, no, not one. Then how did you get saved, young man? Well, I believed in Jesus Christ. Well, that's a pretty righteous act, great thing to do, yeah? Yes? Well, yes, it is pretty good. Well, how did you do that if you were helpless? No one seeking God, no, not one. But you're telling me you sought God. How did that happen? Romans 3:11, there's no one seeking God, no, not one. So, but you're telling me you sought God. How did this happen? And you're telling me that you have a free will, but at the same time, God's the one who saved you. Oh, the squirming begins, but then inevitably out comes the mystery card. Well, it's just a mystery. We can't understand, and we're not meant to understand. Stop thinking about it. How God can be sovereign and you can be sovereign at the same time. Don't even try. It's a mystery how I am not in control of my own salvation, and yet I am in control of my own salvation at the same time. Sounds like a contradiction. No, it is not a contradiction. It's a mystery. It's a mystery. Do you remember those American Idol auditions back in the good old days when you had Randy and Paula and Simon? And I loved it when they showed all the fails. It's kind of embarrassing. It's really cringe-worthy. But these people who have somehow been told all their life by their parents who spoiled them, that they're perfect, they sing beautifully, they're loaded with talent, and they really can't sing at all. And they audition, and it's like gypsies, tramps, and thieves. We hear from the people of the town, they call us gypsies, tramps, and thieves. And they actually think they're the best singers ever. And then they get cut down. Oh, Simon Cowell takes them down. He says, why don't you spend your time pursuing something you can do? You have no future in this. You mean I'm not going on to Hollywood? No, you're not going on to Hollywood. You'll be lucky to make it home on your own. And then when they go out, their friends ask them, what happened? Or their parents say, what happened? You're the best singer. It's a mystery. It's a mystery. We just can't know why the universe pulls awful tricks like this. Somebody with my unbelievable talent, somebody who is obviously set up to be the next American Idol, gifted to be the next American Idol, could be rejected by these so-called professionals. It's can't even be explained. Don't try to even think about it. Don't try to understand it. It's a mystery. Well, that's obviously stupid, isn't it? It's no more stupid than Christians pulling out the mystery card when confronted with their terrible, awful, glaring hypocrisy of being in control of their fate and not in control of their fate at the same time, of being helpless and yet able to help themselves at the same time. They don't know the answer to that, and they squirm when they're confronted. I have a cartoon. You bet I do. I have a cartoon in here about a girl, a little girl who's playing the mystery card. It is on page 67. It's a little cartoon. It's actually called The Mystery Card, and here it is. Okay, I'll show it to you on the screen there. This little girl is, it's funny because these are probably 9-10-year-old girls, and this one girl is explaining it to her friend. If the specter of logic or preponderance of scriptural evidence ever threatens your preconceived orthodox belief system again, Susie, just say, well, I guess it's just a mystery. That's right. Oh, the specter of logic. What damage that will do to someone who is convinced that they can be in control of their salvation and not be in control of it at the same time, that God can be sovereign and not sovereign at the same time, that someone can be helpless and not helpless at the same time. Oh, the specter of logic looming over these terrible hypocrisies is a real threat to these people, and especially the preponderance of scriptural evidence against human free will. That's very damaging to their opinion of themselves, just like those poor people. It's like those poor people on American Idol. They have such a high opinion of themselves, and then they're brought back down to earth, and they just can't explain it. We're bringing these people back down to earth to say, you're helpless. There's no one righteous, no, not one. Not one is seeking out God. And then all they would have to do is think about it. But they can't because they don't want to let go of human free will. This is what they would have to do. Romans 3, 10, 11, 12, all that whole area, there's no one seeking out God. And yet they know that they sought God. They sought God. But how did they do it? Combine that with the magic verse I gave you yesterday. Acts 17, 25, God gives to all life and breath and all. God gives to all life and breath and all. That's the only verse you need to disprove human free will. It's the only verse you need. I got a lot more. And you'll find a lot of them in The Really Bad Thing About Free Will. It's a short read. It's a 45-minute book. Hilarious comics in here that I invented myself. And maybe I'll take you through a couple more of them tomorrow because this is such a good time. Such a good time. So they squirm under these things that they know are contradictions, but they can't let go of human free will because that's what saves them and sends everybody else to hell. They have to hold on to that. So they can't look at this simple equation. No one's seeking out God, and yet I'm seeking out God. How can that be possible? Unless there's a God who claims to be giving everybody everything. In that case, he would give me. He would have to give me the power to seek. If I'm helpless, and yet I find myself reaching out to God, how is that possible? Unless God gives me the strength, invades my world to overcome my helplessness, to cause me to reach out to him. I got to be acted upon by an outside force. That's the simple explanation. A five-year-old can understand it. I can't fly, and yet I'm going to fly, and I'm at an airport. Maybe an airplane's going to take me into the air. Ooh. Yeah, it's that simple. I'm helpless. Yet somehow, by some miracle, by some miracle? Yes, what's the miracle? God invaded your world and helped you. But if he does that, then there's no such thing as, right, there's no such thing as free will. It's a fiction. It's an illusion. You're tricking yourselves. You're robbing yourselves. You're giving the glory of salvation to yourself. It's not a good look, and it's not going to fly. It's not going to fly because you are in denial that salvation is by God and by Christ. That's how dangerous holding to this teaching is, because you basically believe you're your own savior. You believe you're your own savior. Is that going to cause me problem at the great white throne?